It seems so peaceful now, this ancient village where I grew up. It's certainly seen its fair share of action down through the centuries. The plague, the Protestant purges of Queen Mary, the English Civil War, the First World War. But 80 years ago this month, in the skies above these fields, the Battle of Britain was raging, and the people of Marden Village had front row seats.
Hostiles gathering over Calais.
Scramble!
Aeroplanes fell from the sky like flaming comets, and the noise of warfare could sometimes be heard above the soaring notes of the Sunday choir.
When the sirens started wailing, we were told to crawl under our desks at school. Outside, we had these trenches to jump into whenever the Jerrys came over.
Welcome to Fields and Their Secrets, I'm Philip Day. One of the fields featured in this particular episode is the one that you see right behind me. As usual, there's nothing really remarkable about it. It's a field, like any other, that goes through its crop cycle once every year. But let me invite you to join me on an absolutely fascinating local wartime detective hunt.
It's September the 15th, 1940, and the Battle of Britain has been staining the skies over Marden for 8 weeks. On this, the climactic day of the battle, 1,500 aircraft will fight it out over southeast England from dawn to dusk during two huge German air raids. Since July the 10th, the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, has been hammering the Royal Air Force as part of Hitler's plan to defeat Britain's air defences. This is deemed vital before launching Operation Sea Lion, the Nazi air and seaborne invasion of Great Britain.
The problem is, the Royal Air Force is proving hard to kill. With expert logistics, and in spite of its losses, the RAF has managed to maintain its strength thus far. But the strain is starting to tell.
By the morning of September the 15th, a Sunday, Fighter Command has just 269 serviceable Spitfires and 530 Hurricanes to throw at the enemy. And these are outnumbered by the Germans by at least 3-1. But it hasn't all been plain sailing for the Nazis. The Luftwaffe has taken a beating over the past 2 months. Fighter and bomber wings are operating often now at half strength. In just 3 weeks between the middle of August and first week of September, 15% of the Luftwaffe's serviceable aircraft have either been shot down or seriously damaged. In August alone, over 200 German pilots have been killed, 200 more are missing or taken prisoner, and 75 wounded and unfit for further service. The German air crews are exhausted and not a little spooked. The RAF pilots are by no means as cowardly as the Reich's radio keeps reporting. German bomber crews have begun to fear the measures the RAF is using to break up the bomber streams, even more so since the highly aggressive Polish and Czech squadrons became activated.
The German High Command view these reckless tactics as obvious evidence that a desperate RAF is on the ropes. And so it is, on September the 15th, Reichsmarschall Hermann Göring goes for the kill. He knows there's only a small window in which to defeat the RAF and launch the invasion. And it's into this drama that we come across a young RAF pilot officer by the name of Thomas Paul Michael Cooper Slipper.
My father, Michael, later to be known as Mike, was born on January the 11th, 1921, in the small West Midlands village of Kinver. He was the eldest of three children. His father was a farmer, and his grandfather the local vicar. He was always interested in airplanes and things mechanical. He took his first flight in an Avro 504 biplane at the age of 7, and as he said later on, he'd become smitten in flying. He and his brother Bill built motorcycles from scratch, and Mike would race them on dirt ovals. He went to grammar school in Starbridge and completed his certificate by the time he was 16 and a half. Too young to join the RAF at the time, he joined Bolton Paul Aircraft in Wolverhampton as an apprentice. At 17 and a half, he applied to the RAF, took a medical, wrote some exams, and a month later, in the fall of 1938, was on his way to Prestwick as a pilot trainee on probation.
Mike is just 18 at the outbreak of World War II. During the following 8 months of phony war, Mike receives intensive air warfare training at RAF bases around the UK. He's a natural instinctive fighter pilot. Brought to full combat readiness on Hurricanes, Mike is then posted to 605 Squadron at RAF Wick. And not a moment too soon.
Hitler's invasion of Western Europe begins on May the 10th, 1940. The Luftwaffe proves unstoppable during the conquest of the Low Countries, which crumble before the relentless assault of Blitzkrieg. Mike and 605 Squadron are posted south to the forward operating base at Hawkinge on the Kent coast. Across the English Channel, as the British Expeditionary Force is driven back before the German onslaught, the squadron takes heavy losses flying cover for the Dunkirk evacuation. During the next 10 days, Mike undergoes his baptism of fire, during which he shoots down one Heinkel, a Stuka, and a Junkers 88. After Dunkirk, 605 is withdrawn and sent back up north to RAF Drem in Scotland. Here, the squadron rests, reorganizes, and receives new pilots. It remains there during the first part of the Battle of Britain, and then is ordered south again, this time to RAF Croydon, to be thrown back into the action.
Imagine passing your driving test, being allowed to drive for a few days, and then enter for a Grand Prix race against the best drivers in the world on a racing circuit. And by the way, if you lose, you'll probably be crippled or dead. so you'd better learn fast. That's about the size of the challenge that these kids, and they were kids, we talked about 18, 19, 20-year-olds, faced in the summer of 1940.
Go! 605 Squadron is commanded by the no-nonsense Scott Archie McKellar. Mike is in Red Section as Red 2. His section leader, Red 1, is Flight Lieutenant Christopher Current, nicknamed Bunny. Christopher Current. Current Bun. Bunny Current.
Upon arrival at RAF Croydon on September the 7th, my father and 605 Squadron are right back in the thick of it. They find themselves repulsing constant enemy air attacks as the Blitz on London has begun. They fly multiple sorties daily and are dangerously outnumbered, flying themselves to exhaustion.
The very next day, Mike destroys another 109 and damages a Dornier. On the 11th, he damages another Heinkel. On the 12th, Mike shares the downing of a Junkers 88 over the Channel. Meanwhile, Archie McKellar and Bunny Current are racking up their own competitive tallies with their remorseless attacks on the enemy.
Was it fun?
Looking back on it now, it was. I don't think it really was. We're desperately tired. 18-hour days, day after day, probably flying five times in a day. It wasn't the enemy that got you, it was tiredness. You just got so tired you couldn't even think.
Mike writes, "From the 7th of September, we flew ourselves to exhaustion physically and mentally. I managed somehow to get a rest day on Saturday the 14th and flew home to Kinver in the Squadron's Magister. I landed on my father's fields and parked the aircraft overnight, got caught up with my relatives and a few friends who heard I was back."
The following day, September the 15th, is a Sunday. Mike has breakfast with the family and casually glances out of the window at the clear blue skies. He knows the Germans are coming. Mike also knows the flight back to Croydon in the unarmed Magister could be a problem. What Mike doesn't know is that this day for him is going to be a day unlike any other.
Meanwhile, across the North Sea at the Luftwaffe airfield of Derna, just outside Antwerp, the four-man bomber crew of Dornier VAC number 4200 finish a late breakfast. The men prepare their flight kit, walk out to inspect their bomber. Eric Rilling is the pilot, 29 years old. Heinz Hovind is the observer and bombardier. Eugen Zimmermann is the radio operator and top gunner. This is only his second mission. And 27-year-old Helmut Herbel is the flight engineer and gunner. Two major attacks are planned for London today. Eric Rilling and his crew will be part of the second wave of bombers which will depart as the first wave returns. Their target will be London's Victoria and East India docks, as well as the Surrey Commercial docks on the south bank of the Thames. Just after 10:30 a.m., the filter room at Stanmore reports the approach of the first German wave. The 11 Group Operations Room at Uxbridge springs into life. A little later, Mike manages to get the Magister into Croydon unscathed, but has missed 605 Squadron's first sortie.
My father suited up and was ready for the squadron's second flight of the day, just after noon. For some unexplained reason, his ground crew helping him into the hurricane made sure he was more firmly secured and his parachute harness was tightened well beyond normal. Ned thought that was a bit different, but little did he know how grateful he'd be in just under an hour.
Across the North Sea in Belgium, Eric Rilling and his crew pile into their Dornier 17, nicknamed Der Fliegende Bleistift, the Flying Pencil. 19 of these bombers of KG-3 take off for the rendezvous over Calais. Here, they hook up with 95 other bombers and over 400 Messerschmitt 109 fighters, who will be their protection against the Spitfires and Hurricanes that await them.
Two sections, stand by!
Mike is part of a large force of fighters scrambled from airfields all across England's southeast around 1400 hours. Even so, for every two British fighters, there will be three Messerschmitt 109s. The Spitfires will do their best to keep the 109s at bay, while the Hurricanes go about their deadly cull of the bombers. The Chain Home radar station at Dover has detected the huge raid forming over Calais. The RAF squadrons climb to their appointed altitudes and positions. 12 Group's big wing of 60 fighters under Douglas Bader has also been scrambled. It starts to go wrong for the Germans almost immediately. A 90-mile-per-hour high-altitude headwind has developed, which cuts the speed of the bombers and their fighter escorts in half on their way in to the target.
My father writes, "We took off and headed out to the southeast and were vectored towards a large German formation at around 18,000 feet. There were so many aircraft, it looked like overcast in an otherwise clear sky. I had the premonition that this fight would be intense."
The second wave of Dorniers, I did a quarter attack on one, and I was about 50 yards from him, I suppose, and I was getting shot at and hit. And I decided I was going to fly across the top of him. I couldn't get my guns on, I couldn't get around in time, but I could fly around on top.
In Eric Rilling's Dornier, Eugen Zimmermann, the novice top gunner, fires bursts of MG-15 machine gun rounds into the approaching Hurricane. Mike records that the Germans seemed fixated on him.
And then my ailerons were shot away, and I couldn't control the roll. So the airplane rolled a bit, and I hit him in the left wing.
You rammed him?
Yes. With the left wing, my wing came off. And he went on down, controlled it for a while. I think two bailed out, or three, and two were in it. They crashed and were killed. But I went into a spin. I think it was an inverted spin. And I wrenched the cabin back and pulled the nails off doing it. Next thing I knew, I was on the end of a parachute.
All around Mike, all hell is breaking loose at 18,000 feet.
Thank you.
among the many remarkable events that occur that afternoon. In the fog of war, with everything else that's going on, Bunny Current is still able to describe Mike's predicament in his combat report.
I broke away down and beneath enemy aircraft, but looking up at the bombers, saw one enemy aircraft spinning down without port wing. Also one Hurricane spinning down without starboard wing. I then saw four or five parachutes appear, and almost immediately, this enemy aircraft blew to pieces.
As for Mike, the next thing the 19-year-old remembers, he's dangling on the end of his parachute 17,000 feet above the Kent countryside, dopey from the lack of oxygen at such a height.
My father writes, "This was the first time I had ever been on the end of a parachute. It opened with a snap and a bang, and it seemed very tight on me, for which I later thanked my fitters. I never realized the strange noises a parachute makes, lots of crackles and flapping. I tried to see what condition my parachute was in, but I couldn't turn my head up or bend it. My Mae West life jacket was tight behind my head, the irony being it was a German Mae West. Some of us had secured a few and liked the fit better than ours. I could see down, and the thought of doing this for another 3 miles made me feel nauseated."
Meanwhile, in Eric Willing's Dornier, reality is a hurtling nightmare as the bomber starts its mad plunge towards the ground. One of them manages to kick open the escape hatch in the floor. Zimmerman, Herbal, and Hovind jump clear of the bomber. And then comes the explosion. In 1940, this area was Lime Trees Farm, the peaceful home of the Tomlin family. It's just outside Staplehurst, one stop down the railway line from Marden. On the 15th of September, it's not very peaceful. In fact, all hell has just broken loose in the cloudy skies overhead. Frieda Tomlin, the farmer's daughter, kept a diary at the time of the Battle of Britain and recorded all the events that happened around her home.
15th September. At 2 p.m. the siren sounded again. I was walking down the fields to meet Mother, Betty and Bridget when I saw the smoke rising from a plane which had crashed in the direction of Marden. About 4 minutes later, we saw three parachutes coming down over Marden. Then we suddenly heard a roar and saw a bomber diving straight down over Pagehurst. There was a bang when it came down, so we all ran indoors. When the all clear went, there was another terrific bang and a cloud of smoke came up over Pagehurst way. It must have been one of the bomber's bombs going up. We went round by the plane tavern and saw people picking up pieces of airplane for about a mile along that road, so the bomber must have come down near there.
My father jumped from his Hurricane at about 18,000 feet, and as he neared terra firma, his parachute hit some high tension wires, knocking the air from it and collapsing the chute. He landed hard in a plowed field. He was bruised and very dazed. Soon the hop pickers arrived and surrounded him. Some thought he was British, others not so sure, perhaps due to the German Mae West he was wearing. He was prodded with a pitchfork until he let this unruly lot know in his best black country accent that he was RAF. He then became their prized possession, a hero of sorts, and was carried aloft on shoulders, first to a local pub, then a doctor's house, losing buttons from his tunic along the way as souvenirs.
Nick Hode is part of the team on this research project. I've invited Nick along to bring his problem-solving skills to bear on some curious details I'm having a problem with.
Thank you, Nick.
You're welcome.
So you've been through all the paperwork I sent over to you.
I have, yes, yes, indeed.
All right, let's summarise. Mike Cooper Slipper bails out of his Hurricane at 18,000 feet, mm-hmm. parachutes down safely to Earth at Church Farm. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Eric Rilling's three crew members, Zimmerman, Herbal and Hovind,
yep.
parachute down onto Cannon Farm, incidentally not a mile from where Mike comes to Earth. Mm-hmm. They are promptly arrested and later interrogated.
Yes.
Now, you've been studying this report compiled by Squadron Leader Felkin, which contains observations of the incident along with information given to him when he interrogated the prisoners. Would you care to read that central part of the report?
Sure, sure. Okay, one Staffel of nine aircraft was flying with another Staffel when this aircraft was attacked by three Hurricanes, one of which rammed them, all crew bailed out and their parachutes opened. Three have been arrested, the fourth has not been located and is presumably still at large.
So, here are the crew members. The statement alludes to an attack by three Hurricanes, one of which rams their door near. To me, that sounds like Bunny's red section, mm-hmm. of which Ram and Mike is red too.
It also says all the crew bailed out, confirmed by the crew. And Bunny recorded four or five parachutes opening before the Dornier exploded. Well, that looks like the four Dornier crew and Mike. Hmm. One more thing. Look at that report date.
17th of September.
Hmm.
What about it?
Well, 2 days after the incident, the pilot, Eric Rilling, still hasn't been found. Where's Eric?
Nick and I are taking a quick trip out to Lashenden Air Warfare Museum at Headcorn Aerodrome. We're told parts of Eric Rilling's plane are on display there.
Okay, it says here that Dornier VAC number 4200 comes down in Whitehurst Woods, Marden, at 14:30 hours. Eric Rilling bailed out too low.
The trouble is, that doesn't agree with Bunny's report. Or Felkin after interrogating the crew. Apparently, Eric got out of his plane and his parachute opened.
Here's Zimmerman's parachute. It's got his name on it. This would have been recovered when the Luftwaffe lads were captured at Cannon Farm. Rilling's plane comes down at Whitehurst Woods. I know where that is. Something's not right here. All right, let's see what this lot looks like on a map.
Mm-hmm.
After the collision, records show that Mike's Hurricane goes in with a bang at Yordling Lees, which is over here. Mike lands by parachute at Marden's church farm here. All four Germans were seen to bail out of the Dornier. Three land at Cannon Farm here and are immediately arrested. Rilling's missing, and the museum and other sources say their bomber went in at Whitehurst Woods, which is here.
Okay, so let's plot Frieda Tomlin's testimony on the map.
At 2 p.m. the siren sounded again. I was walking down the fields to meet Mother, Betty and Bridget when I saw the smoke rising from a plane which had crashed in the direction of Marden. About 4 minutes later, we saw three parachutes coming down over Marden. Then we suddenly heard a roar and saw a bomber diving straight down over Pagehurst.
Frieda's observing from here, and here's Pagehurst. So she's seeing a bomber coming down over Pagehurst in this area. Beyond Pagehurst, from Frieda's perspective, in direct line of sight is Whitehurst Wood.
There was a bang when it came down, so we all ran indoors. When the all clear went, there was another terrific bang, and a cloud of smoke came up over Pagehurst Way. It must have been one of the bombers' bombs going up. We went round by the plane tavern and saw people picking up pieces of airplane for about a mile along that road. So the bomber must have come down near there.
Plain Tavern is here. It's a private dwelling now. And here's the road along which Frieda sees people picking up bits of the bomber. Can you see it's nowhere near Whitehurst Wood?
Hmm.
That's Wildon Wood.
And there's also the fire brigade report you sent me.
September 15th, 1940. 3:30 p.m. German bomber seen to crash near Marden Fall. Found same in wood near Plain Tavern and Hopper Huts and burning fiercely. Bodies of two occupants in burning machine. Attempting to smother flames with shovels when delayed action bombs exploded. H. Swaffer, A. Cox and Weaver standing by sustained minor shock. Fire extinguished by explosion. 4:40 p.m. returned to station and reported.
All right, so the firemen see two occupants in the burning machine when there should have been none, right? Dornier 17s have a crew of four. All four of Rilling's crew bailed out.
Yep.
Three parachute down onto Cannon Farm, which we've dealt with, and are arrested and subsequently interrogated by Felkin.
And those three somehow floated down to Earth, according to Frieda's report, before their roaring bomber hit the ground. Not very likely, is it?
Wrong bomber. Well, I've only one word to say to that.
Well, do we need to turn the camera off?
So LIDAR, or light detection and ranging, uses lasers to measure the elevation of things like the ground, forests, and even buildings. It's a lot like sonar, which uses sound waves to map things, or radar, which uses radio waves to map things, but a LIDAR system uses light, sent out from a laser.
A Dornier hitting the ground from 18,000 feet, plus delayed action bombs going off, is going to make a big hole. A LIDAR scan could be useful in finding out more. In real terms, LIDAR strips the undergrowth off a forest or a wood, so we can see what lies beneath.
We've got Whitehurst Wood, and we'll just run the scan over it. And so you can see there's nothing of any significance there. We're looking for a pretty substantial impact. All right, so let's go over here to Wildon Wood and run the scan over here.
Ah.
See that?
Yeah.
And interestingly, there's another one just down here, it's... that is actually a natural anomaly on it. It's like a shallow pond, but this one is of interest. And I don't done a little bit of research on this. It's a crater 28 feet across and 8 feet down. And as you see, it's right by the hopper huts, and it's right by the road that runs up to Plain Tavern.
Yeah.
So let's summarise the reasons why the bomber Frieda sees going into Wildenwood cannot be Eric Rilling's Dornier. Number one on my list is, you remember the robust northwest headwind the bombers are fighting on their way into the target?
I do.
Mike's Hurricane goes in at Yording Lees here. Mike bails out at around 18,000 feet and lands here. See the northwest to southeast drift?
Mm. Dornier and Hurricane collide at 18,000 feet, thereabouts. Very similar damage. Both lose a wing, which means they both suffer uncontrolled descent. It's reasonable to suppose that both aircraft come down in approximately the same area.
And so should the parachutists, with the same wind drift. And they do. Mike lands here, and Zimmerman, Herbal and Hovind land over here at Cannon Farm.
Which means we should be looking for Rilling's Dornier up in this area.
Aircraft were falling all over the county that day. Records contradict one another. Experts argue endlessly. But in misplacing Eric Rilling's bomber as the one that crashed in Wildon Wood, we are asked to believe that the crew drifted a mere half a mile against a robust headwind during a 3-mile parachute drop. Not only that, they actually reached the ground even before their roaring bomber hit the wood. Which opens up another mystery that I have no doubt has haunted 4 families in Germany for the past 80 years.
So, 2 questions. Is there any record of a Dornier coming down in Yalding on September the 15th that was anywhere near Mike's Hurricane? And the second question,
who crashed in Wildon Wood?
Today, I'm going undercover, leafy cover, to discover what I can about the impact crater at Wildon Wood. I've telephoned the landowners and also the on-site custodian, and I'm very grateful for their kind permission to visit the site. Yesterday, I contacted 3 what I term serious Battle of Britain researchers who have access to many original records. I've asked them if they can shed any light on our 2 questions, namely, is there a record of a Dornier coming down near Mike's Hurricane in the Yalding area that afternoon? And who crashed in Wildon Wood?
This is a magical place. I'm beginning to think I should have left a trail of breadcrumbs. So, Chris Cooper Slipper and myself have emailed regularly about the project. And I was curious about what became of his father after the extraordinary events of September the 15th.
Army personnel finally arrived in Marden and rescued my father and returned him triumphantly to Croydon that evening. He was sporting 2 more German May Wests and a rubber dinghy given him by the Maidstone police. Upon arriving back at Croydon, he was greeted with, "Hey Slips, you're dead, mate." Apparently, one of the other 605 pilots hadn't seen him bail out and left word he'd been carbonated. As custom had it, a pilot's kit was shared amongst the squadron, a whenever they heard you weren't coming back, and it took my father about 2 weeks to get his kit completely reassembled. The next day at Croydon, he was covered in bruises and black and blue from hitting the ground hard and being dragged across the furrows. He also needed medical attention to the hand he'd injured trying to rip open the hurricane's canopy. He was rested from operations for 10 days until fit enough to fly in combat once again.
Hello, this is Philip. Hello. How are you getting on? Okay. Well, that's not interesting. No trace at all. No, I understand. Would you mind holding on just for one moment? Thank you. Oh, wow. No, sorry. I'm actually down there at the moment. Could you email me over those details right now? Thank you very much.
The researchers I contacted have been working together and have sent over their assessment on the identity of the Dornier and its crew, and even where they came from.
I'm being told that 3 Dornier 17s were shot down in this general area during that afternoon raid of September the 15th. One went in at Beltring, another down here at Kilndown, and this one we've been examining at Wildon Wood. The Beltring bomber is confirmed as Eric Rilling's Dornier, Werk Nummer 4200, which makes sense from our own previous wind drift assessment. The Kilndown Dornier and crew have also been accounted for and verified. Now, some new information on Wildon Wood. The bomber that ended up in this crater had been previously ascribed to another crew, who the researchers can now confirm were in fact shot down off the coast of northern Kent that afternoon.
These researchers are among the foremost Battle of Britain experts alive today. The painstaking work they do, piecing all the details together. They go on to write that after all the Dornier losses have been verified for that afternoon, we're left with one German crew, which has never been accounted for. A ghost crew. Dornier Werk Nummer 2549 took off that afternoon from its Luftwaffe bomber base at Boissy-Saint-Léger, southeast of Paris, and the 4 crew were never seen again. No bodies were ever identified. These researchers go on to state that the Wildon Wood Dornier fits in with 3 German airmen, unidentified, who were buried at All Saints Church, Staplehurst, 9 days later, on the 24th of September.
Some say lucky breaks, like London buses, come along in threes. We've had another stroke of good fortune, courtesy this time of the archivists at the Marden History Group. Wartime Marden resident Miriam Honus witnessed the same drama that day at Love's Farm, which is on the opposite side of Wildon Wood from Freedom. And Miriam recorded all she saw in her diary.
September the 15th. Soon after 1:30 p.m., the air became full of snarls, zooms, and bursts of machine gun fire, so I stationed myself at the top landing window. The first thing I saw was a large portion of a bomber's wing sailing through the air all by itself. Then through the clouds in the north appeared 3 airmen, all close together, drifting earthwards on their parachutes. Then I could see black smoke rising from the west, so I guessed those 3 airmen were some of the crew of that bomber. Then I went to look through my window and heard the horrible whine of a bomber out of control. Through the clouds, nosediving to the earth, came a Dornier 17. At first, I thought it would land on Mr. Russell's bungalow, but it finished its career in Whitehurst Wood. Blood red flames in the shape of a huge inverted pear shot up to the sky, then died down to be followed by dense clouds of black smoke. At 4:15 p.m., the bombs exploded in the Dornier in Whitehurst Wood. The noise was terrific. And a huge yellowish-brown ball of smoke rose from the spot. The charred bodies of the crew were blown into fragments and hurled up into the fir trees over a wide radius. Gypsies climbed the trees and fetched the pieces down, but many scattered bones were left in the wood.
I think the Germans packed it in to a large degree after September the 15th. That was a big day for the RAF and continues to be remembered as such. The Luftwaffe didn't quit exactly, but they certainly eased off. There weren't the massive daytime raids after the 15th, and they soon switched to night bombing of London, the Blitz. To avoid the slaughter the RAF pilots were dishing out, the Battle of Britain had been won.
Göring has failed to achieve the required air superiority over England for the invasion to take place. Suffering unacceptable aircrew losses, and with the Luftwaffe badly damaged, Hitler postpones Sea Lion 2 days later. The plan will never be put into action. I've just arrived at All Saints Church at Staplehurst. I telephoned the vicar, a wonderful lady, the Reverend Zilke Tetzlaff, herself German, and explained about the bomber that came down in the wood. She and two very helpful colleagues have been able to confirm from church records that three unidentified German airmen were indeed buried here on September the 24th during the Battle of Britain. The records specifically link this crew as having come from the bomber crashed in the wood. The vicar has emailed over these photographs. One of the archivists has laid her computer tablet over the precise spot where these men, whom we believe to be Gunter Flaming and his crew, were laid to rest.
Mm-hmm.
These German lads were in some quite good company. This is Flight Lieutenant Freddy Rushmer of 603 Squadron out of RAF Hornchurch in Essex. Freddy was 30 years old when he was shot down in the Battle of Britain on the 5th of September, and he was buried as an unknown airman since neither Freddy nor his Spitfire could be identified. Years later, a pocket watch was found at the site of his crash and was later identified by Freddy's surviving sisters. And so in 1998, a new headstone was cut and Freddy's grave was rededicated.
And over here, another Spitfire pilot. Flying Officer John Wilcox, 72 Squadron. John was just 23 years old when he was shot down during the Battle of Britain, just a mile and a bit across the fields over there at Chickenden Farm.
Of course, there could be no formal identification of these men without categoric evidence. We have a few paths of inquiry ongoing. I've notified the Commonwealth War Graves Commission of our investigation, and they will see this film. Thanks to one of their colleagues, we have been sent a photograph of the final resting place at Cannock of the bomber crew we believe were buried here for 19 years. The inscription reads, "Three unknown German soldiers." Perhaps in the future, like Freddy's, this inscription may be updated too.
Though the Battle of Britain had been won and the invasion forestalled, there was still a war to fight. In the months following, the Luftwaffe mounted numerous small air raids on selected targets around the southeast.
On one occasion, my father returned to Croydon following a short operational sortie. But before disembarking his Hurricane, he was dispatched again to fly south to Hastings to intercept an errant barrage balloon that had escaped its moorings. Along the way, he encountered a Dornier 17 that had obviously been hit and was trailing smoke from one of its engines. He pursued it for a short while, it shot at it, it released its bombs, but then disappeared into cloud. So he turned his Hurricane around, flew back towards Hastings, encountered the barrage balloon, and brought it down in fields behind the town. Returned to Croydon, mission accomplished.
Some months later, in early 1941, Mike Cooper Slipper meets a young lady named Rita in Torquay, down in the West Country. They begin to date. Rita mentions that she's from Hastings. And it's not long before the conversation turns to the bombing that day that nearly destroyed Rita's home.
My father had to admit to his role in the matter. But true love prevailed, and on Guy Fawkes Day, November the 5th, 1941, they were married in Hastings. One could only speculate, of course, that a marriage that was to last for 63 years might never have occurred had my father not been in his Hurricane in that part of the sky, chasing that Dornier 17 at that particular moment.
There's still no sign of Eric Rilling, the missing pilot of Mike's Dornier. The three German aircrew were convinced that their pilot got out of the bomber. But what if the fourth parachute that was sailing down with them all the way to Marden wasn't Eric Rilling at all, but Mike Cooper Slipper, the RAF pilot who'd rammed them? If Eric did in fact get clear of the bomber but bailed out too low, it might be worth ringing round a few places to see if anyone's got a record of him.
I've spent the morning contacting the regional coroner, the Kent County Council archives, Kent Police Headquarters, and dispatched a blizzard of emails into churches in the surrounding area. Later that afternoon, I receive an email from Father Paul Kish, the Vicar of Yalding. After reading my email inquiry, Father Paul took the trouble to trawl through his church records and came up with two entries. Firstly, in the Register of Burials for September 1940, we find this. Erich Joseph Rilling, German airman found at Beltring Holt, September the 15th, 1940. And I almost missed the entry right below it, Helmus or Helmut Schutz, a German airman found at Rugmer Farm Collier Street, just up the road, 3 days after Erich, on September the 18th. A quick trawl of the Marden Aviation History booklet reveals that Feldwebel Helmut Schutz was the pilot of a Dornier 215 on a photo reconnaissance mission when it was shot down over Collier Street on Wednesday, September the 18th. Apparently, Helmut stayed at his controls to give his three crew the chance to bail out. They were captured. Helmut, aged 24, died in the crash.
Church records indicate that the plot where these twins now lie was where Erich Rilling and Helmut Schutz were laid to rest in September of 1940. This is an absolutely beautiful spot in ancient Yalding, a village that existed, like Marden, 1,000 years ago, even before the Norman conquest.
Not widely known is that some 5,000 German and Austrian military personnel died in Britain during both World Wars. In the First World War, these were mostly prisoners brought over from Europe. In World War II, there were also pilots and aircrew who were shot down. These men were buried in the villages and towns around the country, quite often close by their Royal Air Force counterparts.
October the 16th, 1959, Britain and Germany agreed to establish a national cemetery in Britain. This was for the future care of the remains of these German and Austrian military personnel. After 21 years, Erich and Helmut are transferred up to Cannock Chase on August the 7th, 1961. Our photographic contact at Cannock has kindly sent over a picture of their grave. For some, the war and their lives ended in these fields and woods. For others, there would be further adventures in faraway places.
2 weeks after my parents were married, my father was posted abroad. Throughout the war, Mike served his country with distinction in 4 theaters of combat: Dunkirk, the Battle of Britain, the Battle of Singapore, in the North African campaign. After the war, my parents emigrated to Canada. Mike became a test pilot for AV Row Limited, and in the mid-1950s became chief test pilot for the Orenda Engine Company. He flew high-performance jet aircraft, like the F-86 Orenda-powered Sabre, the CF-100, and flight-tested the mighty Iroquois engine on a modified B-47 Stratojet. In 2003, in recognition of a life's contribution to aviation, Mike was inducted into Canada's Aviation Hall of Fame.
Mike and Rita retire in 1986 to Victoria, British Columbia, where Mike pursues his love of photography and aviation history. On a trip to England in the mid-1980s, Mike and his son Chris meet up with old friends. Steve Vizard, the world-renowned Spitfire restorer and Battle of Britain researcher, recalls the occasion.
When Mike and Chris came over in the mid-80s, we took them out to the site of where his Hurricane had crashed, just outside Yalding, in the Yalding Lees on Woodfall's farm, which is a site that I'd known about since the mid-1970s. And we decided, because he was interested, to organise a small-scale excavation of the site to see if there's anything that might still remain. We had found a few parts there over the years, just digging with spades, but we'd never actually put a JCB, a digger, on the site to excavate it. One of the things we did find, which I've kept over the years, is the part of the rocker cover from the Rolls-Royce Merlin engine. And you can just see the rolls and just going into Royce. This would have been about 4 feet long, and there'd been one on one side of the engine, it's a V12, one on the other side. So that was one bit that we did find when we went to the site for the excavation.
You were reunited recently with an old friend.
Yes, went and dug my airplane up, bits of it. You are? That used to be a tachometer.
A tachometer?
The engine speed indicator.
This was with you, what, was it 5 miles up when you got hit?
4 miles.
4 miles up?
When I hit, yeah. And that was dug out of the ground 48 years later.
It goes through your mind when you hold that piece of metal.
I'm glad it wasn't my face that made it like that.
My father was regarded as a war hero. To others, he was simply known as Mike, a young lad from Kinver, Staffordshire, who volunteered to join the RAF in 1938 at the age of 17 and a half. Mike was a good husband to Rita for 63 years, and a loving grandfather to Jessica, and a great dad and best friend to me, who helped me immensely in establishing my own aviation career. Of all my father's possessions, most cherished are these medals. And amongst them, the Distinguished Flying Cross, which was awarded to Mike in November 1940, 2 months after the ramming incident. The citation read, "The King has been graciously pleased to approve the following recognition of gallantry displayed in flying operations against the enemy. Flying Officer Cooper Slipper of 605 Squadron has displayed great skill and daring in air combat, and on one occasion deliberately rammed and destroyed a hostile aircraft after his own controls had been practically shot away. He has destroyed 7 enemy aircraft and damaged 3 others." You know, there's a term in aviation that is used when describing the qualities that contribute to making an excellent test pilot or outstanding fighter pilot. It's called being made of the right stuff. And Mike certainly had all that embodied.